Hi, I'm Jenny Brocchi. Tonight on Insight, cancer breakthroughs. How far have we come?
And that pink mark shows a very active, hot tumour.
Cancers are clever. They work out ways of getting around our drugs.
All of a sudden, we had a drug tailor-made for this exact cancer.
So about a year ago, you were in palliative care.
Yes, literally a year ago.
And now you're sitting here.
I am, and I'm alive.
Welcome, everyone. Good to have you with us tonight. Navzad, let me start with you. 2 years ago, when you were 16, you were rushed to hospital for an MRI after getting terrible headaches and being terribly sick. What did that MRI show?
Well, I didn't actually see the MRI, to be honest. They didn't even tell me until, like, 1 week after my brain surgery. So I was pretty left in the dark, like, for the first part of my treatment.
But Mum knew?
Yeah.
What did you find out?
He had multiple brain tumours and it was very, very serious, and there's a lot of pressure on his brain which had to be relieved through an operation, otherwise he wouldn't have lasted that night.
Mm. Now, multiple tumours. Did you have any inkling that it was going to be this serious, either of you?
I had no idea. Like, what all my GPs and doctors were saying to me is, like, since I had just started year 11, they thought it was anxiety or some mental problems, like I'd be...
Headaches
and...
Eye problems.
Yeah, eye problems. My eyes had kind of like rolled back and I could only use one eye at a time. So it was pretty scary and
It was a complete shock to us because first of all, we're a normal, happy family. No, you know, problems in the family. And just to have someone, we always think, you know, cancer is not something that'll happen to us, it'll happen to someone else, not us.
And someone older, presumably, younger,
is like unheard of, so to speak. And then to have cancer within the family, or just to be told that, and especially brain cancer, it was just too shocking a news for us.
What treatment did you initially have for those brain tumours, Navzad?
I still remember as clear as day, 7th of March, I had emergency surgery. And then I think the very next day, I had emergency radiation to, I think, my spine and to my brain. And apparently it was, like, unheard of. Like, it was pretty rare for someone to go straight in after surgery, to go straight in for radiation. So...
And you had chemotherapy as well?
Yeah. So after, I think, about... I had about 20 radiations, and then I think I had 4 rounds of chemotherapy, which was pretty knocked me out pretty well.
Nazad lost 25 kilos, and he was already a thin boy. He lost 25 kilos. He was really skinny. He was burnt out inside, and his whole mouth and his gullet and everything. So he couldn't eat. He couldn't even have water. So he had to be spoon-fed water, and then finally he had to put a nasal tube to his stomach so that he could get some nutrition in his body.
Hmm. Jeff, Navzad's treatment at this stage was pretty typical for kids with this type of cancer.
Yeah, absolutely. This is a pretty typical experience. It was high drama, big surgery and then big radiotherapy, and then he went on to the very strong chemotherapy, standard chemotherapy drugs, the sort of drugs that essentially kill cells that are dividing too fast, and they catch a lot of normal tissues up at the same time. So pretty standard stuff and quite the ordeal.
Yeah. Navzad, you then went into remission in December 2012, but the tumours then grew back last June and you had surgery.
Yeah, so that was right before HSE, which was pretty stressful for me as well. But, when I went to re-admission and I had that second surgery, it was a lot better, but still, like, it left me pretty weak and I'd still be on a lot of, like painkillers and stuff, so I'd still be a bit in and out of, like reality kind of...
OK, we're heading somewhere here because I want to ask Jeff about what you suggested. You suggested a biopsy sample from Navzad's tumour be sent off to the US for genetic testing, didn't you? Why did you suggest that?
That's right. So normally you do a biopsy and you look at it with a microscope and the pathologist says it's this sort of tumour or that sort of tumour. But on this occasion, firstly, the pathologist had always struggled to say exactly what sort of tumour did NAVZAD have. But secondly, there's a growing movement to analyse tumours in great depth. And there's a company in America, a commercial operation, who you could send a tumour sample to, and they will analyse it for expression of all sorts of genes and genetic mutations in the tumour cells and proteins and come up with some suggestions for what drugs might work.
And what did you find?
Well, we found this one abnormality in one gene called the BRAF gene, and there was one abnormality where one little chemical in it was swapped to another chemical, so that's called a BRAF mutation, and that changed everything.
How?
Well, BRAF mutation is well described in a lot of adult cancers, particularly malignant melanoma, and there's a whole class of drugs that have been designed specifically to interact with the BRAF mutation and to kill the cancer cells. So all of a sudden, we had a drug tailor-made for this exact cancer.
OK, we'll get on to what happened with you, NAVZAD, because it's a great story in terms of the outcome with that. But before we do, I want to find out a bit more about this machine. David Thomas, you have got the latest gene sequencing, one of the latest gene sequencing machines, just a few months ago at your Cancer Research Centre in Sydney. Let's have a look at how the machine works.
Cancer is a genetic disease, and understanding the genetic drivers of cancer has been a game changer.
We're one of three centres in the world to have the latest in gene sequencing technologies. Up until we acquired these machines, we could do tens, maybe hundreds of cancer genomes a year. With this technology, we're able to do tens of thousands of samples and cancer patients on these machines every year. That's a game changer that represents a major advance in cancer research. So you see this simple slide. On this simple slide, there are millions and millions of pieces of DNA attached. How cancer forms is that there are a series of changes or mutations in DNA. If we figure out what those changes are, then they potentially tell us not only about how cancers form, but they also contain targets for therapies that we can potentially apply. So to get the DNA on this slide, we start off with the tumour. We take the tumour, we extract the DNA from the tumour, we break it up into small pieces, and then those pieces are chemically modified and then attached to this slide. This slide is then put into the HiSeq 10, and then a sequence is generated for each of millions and millions of fragments of DNA. After we get that sequence, we stitch them together to create the genome of the cancer from which the DNA was originally extracted. It tells us exactly the changes that are present in the cancer cell's genome that make it a cancer. That's the holy grail here, to understand the genetic events that are required to turn a normal cell into a cancer cell.
David, so gene sequencing is actually changing our understanding of how complex cancer really is, or can be.
That's right. It's doing interesting things to the way that we think about cancers in general. It's turning cancers that are quite common into multiple different subtypes, each with their own particular genetic drivers, their own particular mutation patterns, and therefore potentially their own particular treatments. But it's also taking cancers that have not been studied before and identifying within those cancers common targets that perhaps we've tested treatments out on in more common cancers, and we're finding new opportunities to apply those treatments.
So two cancers from completely different tissues, from completely different parts of the body, could share the same mutation, and the drugs that are developed for one of those cancer types could actually work on another cancer in another part of the body.
Well, that's the premise, and it turns out to be true in many cases. Not all, unfortunately, but in many cases that turns out to be true.
And, Jeff, that's exactly what happened with NAVZAD.
Exactly.
Yeah?
Melanoma drug is what we gave him. This wasn't melanoma. It was a brain tumour.
But it had the same mutation.
Exactly.
And what did it mean? Where are you up to now, NAVZAD?
Well, it's so much better. Like, they're just two little kind of pink tablets, and it's made so much, like, of a difference. There's no side effects, I've found, like, to this new treatment I've got, and it I find it's like really good, like compared to what I've had before.
And what's happened to the tumour?
Oh, well, what they've told me, it reduced like a lot.
I think we've got pictures of it here. Yeah. So that's the original tumour, that pink. That pink mark, yes. Yeah?
So that pink mark at the back, this is called a PET scan, shows you how much the tumour's using glucose and protein. And that pink mark shows a very active, hot tumour.
OK, and let's have a look at the photo now.
Now, this is 2 months later. He's done the HSC trials in this time. He's
had, good grief.
He's had no side effects. I've barely seen him. And, well, there it is. It's barely there anymore.
That's extraordinary. Fantastic. Extraordinary story. John Salzberg, we looked at cancer treatment back in 2006 on this program, and you were on that show. Is this one of the biggest developments in cancer treatment since we last spoke to you?
Yeah, when we spoke 8 years ago now, this was a bit of a dream, really. We were doing it in the isolated cases, but not in the way that we're doing it now. So suddenly, we're looking for these genetic mutations in many tumours, if not all tumours. And in this case, it was a tumour in which Jeff mentioned they really weren't sure what the tumour origin was. But even when we know what the anatomic origin of the tumour is, we're still looking for these mutations, these abnormalities, that may give us a sense of how we can target those mutations.
So as oncologists, does that mean you look less now at the location of a cancer and more at its...
I would say we're in a transition zone. I think we still need to look at the location. I don't think we've moved away from that completely. There are some people who believe that we'll never need to worry about the location in the future ever more. We'll just look at the genetics, the genetic tests that David prints off the machine. I think that may be the future. We're not there yet. We're this whole field is in its infancy, though. Mm. And as David indicated, we'll get millions of readouts from these sequencing data. But which of them are important and which aren't? Mm. How will we use it all? Will we have drugs that access all these abnormalities? Are there drugs available, even if they're available for a different tumour? Mm. Are they even manufactured yet? And how will they be developed? So we do have a long way to go, but certainly the field has changed dramatically over the past 8 years.
And David, your machine isn't being used to test people yet, is that right? It's being used more for research purposes
at the moment? The number of genes that we can... what we might call actionable, that is, which could lead to a change in management, is still very small. So that sort of comprehensive analysis is more about research at this point, generating the data that will ultimately lead to treatments down the track.
One question, John. If you have a particular mutation of a gene, does it automatically mean that the drug that's targeted to that mutation will work on you?
So I think, as David indicated, it sometimes means that and it sometimes doesn't. And that's part of the challenge, really, of knowing what to do. I think in the example we've heard, it's been it's fantastic. It's really inspiring to hear what Jeff did and the outcome of that therapeutic trial of N equals one. But, for example, the same gene is abnormal in colon cancer. So BRAF mutations occur in colon cancer as they occur in melanoma and as they've occurred in this particular example of brain tumour. And yet in colon cancer, those drugs don't cause the impact. They don't cause those tumours to shrink.
Melissa, you're a melanoma patient and you have the same mutation in the BRAF gene as Navzad.
Yes.
When were you diagnosed with melanoma?
2009, August the 3rd, which is my mum's birthday. And so it was a melanoma in my belly button, which was excised. 2 years later, it had metastasized to my lungs. And so we came to Peter Mac, where Grant MacArthur has become an oncologist.
And you were treated with a targeted drug, a BRAF inhibitor as well.
Combined with the MEK inhibitor as well.
Another inhibitor as well.
Yes.
Okay, so two targeted drugs.
Yes.
Yeah?
And
did it work?
It did for 14 months, which was fantastic. However, my blood-brain barrier was too good and then the melanoma metastasised in my brain. So then I had mets in my brain, so we treated that with stereotactic radiation as well as whole brain radiation, which worked for some time. About 5 to 6 months, but then several of them continued to grow. So then we had brain surgery as well, which worked again for a little while, but then it became aggressive again and metastasized again in my abdominal, pelvis and my brain again. And at that point, it was very, very aggressive, and I was radiation and chemo, and basically I was in palliative care.
How long ago?
This was the beginning of footy season, which was last year.
Not that you're a fan or anything.
No. So that was the end of March 2013 last year.
Okay.
Yes. So, yeah. That's...
All right. So about a year ago, you were in palliative care.
Yes, literally a year ago.
And now you're sitting here.
I am. Mm. And I'm alive.
Okay. Grant, you're Melissa's oncologist. What were her treatment options once all those other treatments had stopped working and she was in palliative care?
So we had very limited treatment options. We could try some chemotherapy drugs, but we know in the disease of melanoma that they rarely work, and if they do work, not for very long. And there were these new immune-based treatments that we knew would work for some patients.
This is not immunotherapy,
all.
Is it?
As That's right. Not. So this yep. are, these are treatments where there is an infusion given into the body of an antibody that actually turns on the body's own immune system to help fight cancer. Mm. And this has been most well characterised in the disease of melanoma, where now 20% of patients treated with one of these immune stimulating treatments called ipilimumab, complicated
or
name.
Yervoy.
Or Yervoy, yes.
Otherwise not.
This treatment, 20% of patients will survive for prolonged periods of time.
20% of melanoma patients?
Correct. Or? Correct. 20% okay. of melanoma patients with advanced melanoma, so people where the melanoma has spread around the body, will go into a stable disease, or the tumours will disappear, and that is very durable. And that's what is quite remarkable about these new immunologic treatments.
When you say durable, what do you mean? Yeah. Or what sort of time does it give people?
Cancers are clever. They work out ways of getting around our drugs, particularly a disease like melanoma that has lots of mutations. And so the treatments stop working and there's a need to change. And what's quite remarkable about these new treatments to activate the immune system is that for a significant proportion of patients, they keep working.
Melissa, you yes. obviously went well on this drug, on this immunotherapy drug. How are you now?
Better than I expected.
Well, better than you could have ever imagined in palliative care.
Yes. It's... When I was at my worst, I guess, I didn't... you're so pumped up on drugs and that you don't necessarily understand what's going on. But, like, I lost mobility in one side of my body, and my speech went as a result of where the mets were, so in my brain. So I literally got down to about 40 kilos. I couldn't move. So you know things are very, very bad. And we had all the plans worked out in terms of my funeral and all that sort of stuff. And three times, I believe, my family said goodbye. So it wasn't a good expectation, and that was the last ditch effort. So you just hang on, and then it takes a little while for the Yervoy to kick in, like for your immune system to respond with that drug. So you're just sort of waiting and hoping. As your immune system is kicking in and fighting that melanoma, you start to come good and you realise that it's starting to work, and then you get a little scan that says, hey, it's actually starting to work, and that encourages you. And it is, you know, a miracle, so to speak, and they say it might only last for a couple of, you know, months or whatever, but it's been, since the actual injections, it's been 12 months now. And I've been to rehab and learnt how to walk again, and as you can now hear, I can talk properly again, and, you know, I'm actually running now. And that's what these drugs can do now. It's not an actual cure. It gets you time, in my case, in melanoma. And that's what venurafenib did for me. It got me to the next cure or the next hope, which was Yervoy. So.
And you've had a recent scan. What did that show?
The last one was no active melanoma. But just before that, like, I had a little mutated melanoma that was cut out. So I was expecting the worst. My mindset was, no matter what this scan is, if it's bad or good, I'll go get myself some new runners, and so that I'll just keep myself physically fit for the next treatment, whatever that is. And so when we got the good news, I didn't hear anything Grant said after that. I was just saying, I've got to go get myself some new runners. And we go out and Dad said, let's go get some champagne. And I said, no, we've got to get new runners.
I think we've actually got what actually happened here in terms of
but
the runners.
But we got the runners first, and I bought Dad some new runners as well.
That's great. It's a great story. Did you have any side effects with this immunotherapy?
Yes, it played with my thyroid, I believe. So I lost a lot of weight. I got down to about 40 kilos. And so we had some hormone replacement, which has got my weight back up to a reasonable amount. And a rash and that, which is now back under control. So, and my white blood cells are just under par, so to speak, but it's not anything that is life-threatening.
So where is immunotherapy then having the biggest impact in cancer at the moment?
The cancers that have the most mutations, those that are the most crazy, those that are hardest to treat, are probably the ones it's turning out that are responding better to immunotherapies. So melanoma, lung cancer that's damaged by smoking, bladder cancer, head and neck cancer, gastric, stomach cancer. So what I'm really excited about for the future is that we can use the targeted therapies to get cancers under control, and then we can try to eradicate what's left with the immune system. So if the cells are a bit crazy, they're different, they're hard for the targeted drugs to get them under control, then we can bring the immune system in to wipe them out.
Somehow we need to change the image of the pancreas.
Bowels, we all have them, we all use them, but nobody likes to talk about them. And it does kill a conversation, and it certainly kills many Australians at the same time.
John, before the break, we were talking about some promising new cancer treatments. Where has the least progress been made with cancer?
Pancreas cancer, of course, is one of those tumours that we haven't made a lot of progress over the past decade. There are about 2,500 new patients diagnosed with cancer every year in Australia, and about 2,000 and so deaths every year from pancreas cancer. It's not the same people, I'm not trying to suggest that, but just to illustrate that cancers of the pancreas are difficult diseases to treat, and there haven't been enormous progress.
What about survival rates? I mean, where has the least progress been made, Grant?
Lung cancer. Fortunately, lung cancer rates are falling significantly because of public health measures to reduce smoking. But once you've had the diagnosis, there hasn't been, major progress, except in some very small subsets of lung cancer.
Erica, you have pancreatic cancer and your mum died from it 30 years ago. What does that feel like to you in terms of the progress with treatment and so on in that time?
Well, I guess that's really one of the hardest things to deal with is that the 5-year survival rate has not changed in all of that time. Certainly I've had a few more treatment options than my mother had. She went into hospital and didn't come home. She died within 6 weeks. So,
how long have you had it?
I was diagnosed in January of 2012. So I'm doing very well according to the statistics. But I was able to have surgery in February of 2012. I'm currently having my second lot of chemotherapy.
And none of the breakthrough drugs that we've been talking about apply here?
No.
And you've said that people don't want to talk about it. Why do you think people don't want to talk about pancreatic cancer?
Well, I think what happens to a lot of people is that they're diagnosed, they get sick very quickly, and they may die within a few months. Their family is shattered, and they just want to try and heal and move on with their lives. I think the other thing is that not many people know much about their pancreas. It doesn't have a very good image. Somehow we need to change the image of the pancreas.
We need to make people care about the pancreas.
Yeah, care about their pancreas. So there's not a lot of public awareness about it.
Ian, you have bowel cancer, which is one of the most common cancers in Australia. You've sent off a biopsy of your tumour to be genetically tested, like Navzad did. What are you hoping to find?
Hopefully we can map that through to why I have cancer and somebody else doesn't, and also what aligns between the DNA from yourself or somebody else. If I have that same sort of DNA strand or whatever there, that drug may be targeted for my...
Okay, so you're after a... you're hoping that you might be able to... this might lead to a targeted drug.
There's no expectations in the short term. It's from what I've been described, it's a long-term process there. The DNA research is going to be well ahead of what the drug companies are able to do. So it's going to be a catch-up.
Julian, you're the CEO of Bowel Cancer Australia. How many treatment options are there for bowel cancer compared to other cancers?
Certainly, when we're talking about advanced disease and targeted therapies, biological agents, there's that many. Five in Australia at the moment, five available, of which around about three are on the PBS as a subsidised treatment for patients. So not a great deal.
And how does that compare to other cancers?
I think it varies from cancer to cancer. There are certainly more in other cancers and less in other cancers. So I think we're probably middle of the road, as it were.
Have survival rates improved much for bowel cancers in the last decade compared to some other cancers?
Survival for bowel cancer has actually increased from around about 48% to 66% where it currently is. It certainly lags the breast and melanoma and prostate cancers, which are up around the 90% mark. We'd ideally like the 90% targets to be achieved, if not a cure.
And why aren't you reaching those targets, do you think?
It's a bit like pancreatic cancer, I'm afraid. It's bowels. We all have them, we all use them, but nobody likes to talk about them. And it does kill a conversation, and it certainly kills many Australians at the same time.
But how does that affect the outcome of you know, whether or not treatments are developed and treatments work? How is there a connection between people talking about it and what happens with treatment and research development?
Public awareness is fundamental, because the more people who become aware about it, the more people who are openly able to talk about the disease, also does attract then support for the organisations like ourselves, which in turn then are able to generate more income to actually fund more research. And so that's the sort of the circle, as it were, coming to fruition.
I'm interested in this idea of research money and the incidences of cancer and how deadly individual cancers are. Some cancers are getting a lot of money in research relative to other cancers. Why do people think that is? John, why do you think that is?
Well, look, I think it's a complex equation. I certainly think that when you've got advocacy for an area, what you do is you generate funds and through advocacy and generate more research. More research leads to more researchers write grants and there's more research that goes on. So there's certainly a linkage between funding and the amount of research that goes on.
So do people think we've got the balance right in terms of where the research dollars are going?
So, Jenny, I think we need to invest our research dollars where we're going to get the greatest impact. In fact, if you look at the last two cancers we've just been discussing, pancreas and colorectal cancer, we have a gene there that gets mutated in over 90% of pancreatic cancer and almost half of colorectal cancers, which is a gene called RAS. So if you can study RAS, it doesn't matter if it's in breast cancer or melanoma or lung, and you get a breakthrough against RAS, that's going to help pancreas cancers.
I tend to look at the survival rates, and when you've got some that are already up there at the 90%, we've grown up enough to start looking down the ranks to see where we can actually bring the other cancers now up to those sorts of levels. It's a return on investment, as it were. But also...
So when you refer to 90%, are you referring to breast cancer, that you think that because its survival
prostate,
rates
melanoma,
are
melanoma, there are a number of cancers that are actually survival for 5 years for patients is up around the 90% mark. So from bowel cancer's point of view, we're still lagging at 66%. We have a screening program which unfortunately isn't being taken up. Unfortunately, you know, previous governments have looked at the screening program and told us it's 2034 before we'd even have a fully implemented one. Compared that to, say, breast cancer screening, when it took around about 5 years to get mammography up around the country. So this is the sort of disparities we're looking at. And it comes back to your point, once again, that nobody likes to talk about pancreases or bowels.
OK, Erica, you were nodding about this?
Well, it's just that pancreatic cancer has a five-year survival rate of 5%. So we're looking at huge disparities there as far as survival rates go. Makes bowel cancer look good by comparison. Mm.
So you'd like to see more research money going into pancreatic cancer?
Obviously. Yeah, I have a personal investment in that.
Yes, indeed. Maxine, what's your reaction? I mean, can you understand why people, you know, involved in advocating for research for other areas would be concerned about just getting a bit lost in all of that?
I think the success with breast cancer survival is a number of factors, and that includes screening program, an effective screening program, and good participation rates, and also better awareness. And you find a lump and you might be more likely to do something about it, and also the improved treatments. But it does come back to, I guess, on the quality of the research that's put forward for funding. It's not deciding whether to fund bowel this year or breast this year. It comes back to the NHMRC making decisions around what they fund. But I would say, though, that breast cancer has been very effective at fundraising, and I think we should think of growing the pie rather than thinking we're competing with each other and trying to get this the same money.
Mm. I should point out here that we did approach the National Health and Medical Research Council, but it wasn't able to provide someone to be in this discussion this evening. You might be wondering why we're having this talk about research funding without talking to them. What about lung cancer, Frank? I mean, you've been free of lung cancer since 2012. Mm-hmm. Do you have any thoughts about the kind of funding it gets for research and development of treatment?
Right. Just observing in the media that you see that breast cancer, for example, there are celebrities advocating about breast cancer checks and that sort of thing. Whereas with lung cancer, unfortunately, it's sort of, there's a stigma there that people, when you say that, you know, when they ask you, yeah, what sort of cancer have you got? Like you say, you've got lung cancer. First question they ask you, you've been smoking in the past? Of course, at some stage I did. 35 years ago I smoked, but that was past. And,
so you feel like you get blamed that it's self-inflicted?
Yeah, that's self-inflicted. And in retrospect, you know, I can't blame myself to some extent, but it's in that environment that I grew up. My father died of pancreatic cancer. My mother died of lung cancer, and she wasn't a smoker. So it's actually the genes, for example. And
So you feel there's an attitude to lung cancer different to some of the other cancers?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. I mean, the flip side, Maxine, is why do you think you've done so well? Why do you think you have achieved as much as you have in getting public awareness for breast cancer?
I think it's a simple answer is that it affects so many women. 1 in 8 women are going to be diagnosed in their lifetime, so it affects so many people in the community. So many people are talking about it, and when you think about the age range too of people who are affected, 1 in 5 women diagnosed are going to be in their 40s, and so it has an enormous impact on people who might have children at home and, of course, their partners and broader family members. So it's probably pretty hard to find somebody in the audience that hasn't met someone who's had breast cancer. So I think we've been effective because it has just simply affected so many people.
Bronwyn, you've got another theory as well as to why it's been so effective, haven't you?
Look, I think women are much better at a community level at doing stuff and getting stuff done, you know, with the Herceptin campaign. Well, I was diagnosed with HER2-positive breast cancer in 2005. I didn't even know there was such a thing. And my oncologist said to me, look, that's really bad because it's very aggressive and, you know... But the really great thing is there's this drug called Herceptin, which, you know, in probably 50% chance of stopping your cancer. The problem was that it was going to cost around $60,000 for 12 months of treatment. So we started an advocacy campaign to get it on the PBS. There were women out in the community who were contacting their local members of parliament. There were women who were fundraising. You know, they were getting together and doing stuff. Whereas I don't, you know, it's a generalised statement. I just don't think men are as good as doing that in the community. And
Ian, what do you reckon?
And talking to work groups and things like that, because bowel cancer is a predominantly male side of disease, blokes won't talk about it. They have no idea of what it's going on. I had no idea what bowel cancer was until I was diagnosed. And talking to working groups that, in our business and things like that, these guys sit there with mouth agape. Why could it happen to you?
How do you change that? Creative ideas, Julian, have you got
some? What we've found is it comes down to breaking the ice, and the best way we've found so far is actually just through humour. Everyone knows what toilet humour. You've had your fart jokes, you've done all that. Everyone sniggles and giggles, but that's fine. We do it. But then that's when the ice is broken.
Well, that's men sniggle and giggle a lot more about those jokes, I think, than women do. But go right ahead. It's a start.
So we've run campaigns like Don't Be a Fool, Test Your Stool or Join the Bowel Movement. We play on that to a little degree. But again, it's just breaking the ice, and it has worked. So we know what does work and what doesn't work. And certainly don't be crass about it, that's for sure, because that won't work.
Jenny, I think one of the real problems in our hospital system is that clinical trials aren't seen as core business. They're seen as a sort of a luxury add-on to a cancer service. So the nurses are funded, the doctors are funded, the operating theatres are funded, sort of, but the data managers and the people that manage the regulatory issues and the ethics committees and all of that, you ask a hospital administration to pay for that stuff and you really struggle. And so I really think that clinical trials, even more in this era, need to be seen as core business, because there's hundreds of drugs and we're never going to make sense of this, and we're never going to have access to the drugs in the early days except by being in trials.
You'd like the system to actually be backing those trials.
Children are more likely to be cured of their cancer if they're treated on a trial than if they're not treated on a trial.
So are there targeted drugs for children's cancer? Because children's cancer is different, isn't it?
So some of the targeted therapies from adults work in children. Sometimes we get lucky that way. But in large part, we're still relying on old-fashioned chemotherapy drugs a lot of the time.
And big doses.
We do give big doses. Children's cancers are very sensitive to chemotherapy, so that just encourages people like me, unfortunately, to push the dose up.
And this is what Navzat had.
Absolutely.
You had those big doses, yeah?
Yeah, so it was pretty, like, kill everything, like the good and the bad, and hopefully you'll get better. But I find that what I heard from my chemotherapy, that it barely did anything, like it barely affected my tumour. I would always find that I would always get bad news, and it really brings you kind of down, your morale kind of down, and it just really affects like your mental health more than...
So you're feeling terrible and you're not getting good news.
Yeah, I guess so.
And what, have you had side effects, longer term side effects from those treatments?
So it was pretty hard like remembering like kind of day-to-day stuff, like I would forget like a lot of stuff, like everyday stuff. It would be annoying, really annoying.
I think Navzad, you managed to get 96 in one of your HSC exams.
Wow. Thank you for that. That's
that,
very...
That too after major surgery in June, and then he sat for his trials in September and got 96 without attending year 11.
All right, so your modesty hasn't been affected by this, presumably.
Well... Not really, but it's just it's only math. Like, it's the easiest subject, comes naturally to me, I guess. But...
Well done you. Yeah. That's really amazing thing to be able to achieve. In terms of those big blasts, the reason I ask this question is because it does actually make the development of other forms of treatment all the more important for children, doesn't it?
Definitely.
And do you think enough research funding is going towards children's cancer?
I don't think so. I think we need more funding in childhood cancer. I think we need support for our trials in particular, and we need more support. Every life saved in childhood is many years of survival.
If Ireland can afford Yervoy, why is the life of an Irish person to their government worth more than the life of an Australian?
Lisa, how much did you pay out of your own pocket for your melanoma treatment last year?
It was over $100,000. So my father, I was on the brink of death. So my father organised a fundraiser with over 600 guests, family, friends, work colleagues, where everyone, including Grant as well, came and spoke and raised the money for me, which was fantastic, and that bought me my treatment for Year Boy. So thank you to everyone that was there, which
it saved Melissa's life.
Yeah.
That event, a community event, people getting together to fundraise, saved Melissa's life. Simple as that.
Yeah.
And that drug was then listed on the PBS?
2 months later.
2 months later. So what was the difference then in the cost? What were the difference?
Well, basically $100,000, because it was then listed, I think, for $40, I think, roughly. Yeah.
Wow.
So pretty incredible, which is fantastic for, like, everyone else now that can afford it. So, and that was part of the objective of the night as well, even though I couldn't participate.
What would be the next step for you if the cancer came back?
It would be the anti-PD-1. The cost of that, I believe, is it's an ongoing cost. I think it was quoted at $7,000 a month or something like that. So,
Sue Hill, you're here representing the Pharmaceutical Benefits Advisory Council. Why can't we subsidise these drugs so that people can get the benefits of them?
The way the PBAC works is it's an advisory committee, first of all, to government. Mm-hmm. Under the law, we're required to assess how good a new treatment is compared to what we're already doing. So we get the dossier and we have to look at comparative effectiveness in the product. So does it work compared to what we're doing? Comparative safety. So we have to look at the side effect data. And we also have to look at comparative cost. And that's required under the law. Mm-hmm. So the company has to make a proposal to us at what price it wants to sell the product to the government that means that you get it effectively for free if it's on the PBS. And what we're seeing consistently at the moment with cancer drugs is the prices are doing this. They're going vertical.
So can I just ask you then, is it simply a dollars issue?
No, it's not just about dollars. It's comparative effectiveness first.
So what about when drugs have been used successfully overseas? So in the case of Abraxane, which is listed on the PBS for people with breast cancer, mm-hmm. but has been refused for people with pancreatic cancer. But
I guess that's... Can I correct you there?
Let me finish, please.
Yep. Yep.
Because Abraxane's been used overseas for some time quite successfully with people with pancreatic cancer.
Yep.
I'd like to know why I can't have access to it.
That's a fair question. So we assessed Abraxane for pancreatic cancer in March, about 6 weeks ago, and we recommended listing. So we didn't refuse it. We actually recommended that it should be made available.
And where is that up to? Do you know?
No, I don't actually, because the company now has to decide what to do next.
So the company decides the price. It's going to provide it to the government?
We've recommended at a certain price. So normally what happens is we make a recommendation. Then there's the pricing negotiation has to go on between the company and the Department of Health. That has to be agreed. Then that has to be put before the minister, who has to make the final decision.
Can I comment as well?
Yeah,
so
sure.
I chair the Abraxane Advisory Board for the company, just so that you're aware of that. What the company has said to the community, clinical community, is that the price offered was substantially less than they could afford to release it. They stopped a compassionate access program at the time that the PBS decision was told to them. And now no one gets it unless they pay for it, essentially. But what I think we're hearing is a failure of the system.
Now, you've declared an interest here that you advise one of Correct. These drug companies, and I want to just underline that for everybody watching because I think it's very important. Sue, response from you?
So I think we have to be clear about how the system works, first of all, before we say it's a failure.
But is our system too slow or too unwieldy, do you think?
I don't think it's too slow. We take 17 weeks to assess from beginning to end. But what we are dependent on is a sponsor putting in the submission. So if a sponsor says, Australia has a market of 23 million people, I think there are 10 people with this cancer, I'm not going to bother putting the drug in for funding or for registration through TGA, we can't go out and compel them to supply. The US has a market of 300 million people. It has no price setting, so there's a lot of incentives for sponsors to supply drugs there because they've got a broader market to sell it to.
So you're saying there's more things to weigh up here because we have a smaller population?
Absolutely. I think one of the things that has to be clear is that Australians expect the drugs that they want to be available, and they expect them to be safe and effective and work and be free, or close to free.
Well, me, though, personally, when you're in that situation where it is literally life or death, I will take the chance on something with risks and, you know, and if I'm going to die anyway, I'll take the chances on that risk factor. In terms of paying for something that may not be 100% safe, mm-hmm. I would rather take that risk and, you know, and go for it.
And that's a very human point to inject into
the
discussion.
I think that's a really, really important thing to say, because I think one of the things that we all have to do in the system is say, where is it the patient-doctor conversation that means that we should have this product available but through clinical trials,
yes.
with data capture?
Yes.
And the more data capture we have and the more trials we have, the more formal trials we have, so that everybody's on an equal footing, I think the better the system will be. Mm-hmm.
John, what about looking at the cost that the companies are demanding for the drugs?
I think that in the end, look, from my perspective, I'm a clinician, I'm interested in providing drugs to patients. I accept that companies make profits. That's the capitalist system we work in, and if they don't make profits, there won't be any new drugs. No one develops new drugs apart from companies. So if we don't have companies developing new drugs, if they don't make profits, there will be no new drugs. So that's just life, you know. Cars cost money, iPads cost money, drugs cost money. If you work out the cost effectiveness of fixing up a black spot on the road, it costs a lot more than the cost effectiveness we value people's lives.
Are the drug companies asking too much money? I mean, they do have to invest in a lot of research to get these drugs to the point they are.
But I think that's a discussion we should be having. Yeah.
I mean, I think we ought to discuss how much companies are asking us to pay for drugs. They don't wish to disclose the real prices they're charging for these drugs, and also what profit they're making, what margin they're making on the drugs. And once that comes out into the public domain, I think it will allow a much more open debate about really how much of a markup is it reasonable to put on a drug. And we see that with applications to PBAC, the price of the drug falls with subsequent applications, which gives you the sense that really the first application is an ambit claim on pay us whatever you've got. And that's the problem.
Let's take Yervoy, the drug that, you know, is why Melissa's here tonight with us. So March 2011, Americans had access to Yervoy with advanced melanoma. It only got reimbursed in Australia in August 2013. So it was reimbursed in Ireland, a smaller country than Australia, well before Australia got reimbursement for Yervoy. So I don't think it is about market size. I think we're very slow. Our system is very slow. And the other thing that really, you know, strikes me from a personal perspective, if Ireland can afford Yervoy, why is the life of an Irish person to their government worth, you know, more than the life of an Australian at the same time?
And in the interest of transparency, can I just ask any of you, do you have any connections with any of these companies? Do you advise any of them or anything like that?
So I give advice to pharmaceutical companies for free, because I don't want to generate any conflicts of interest, so I don't get paid.
OK, important to get that on the table, I think, with everybody. OK, David, I want to ask you, how long do you think it'll be before mapping the cancer genome with the technology you have becomes a normal part of a person's treatment?
When we get to the point of screening the entire genome and using that in a clinical space, it's very hard to say. I would say we're 5, 10, 15 years away from getting there, but it depends upon the pace of change.
And what will that mean for people getting cancer into the next decade?
It's so exciting, the possibilities. We might be able to identify why somebody gets cancer and the next person doesn't. And if we can know that before people get cancer, can we tailor screening strategies in a more effective way to those people who are at highest risk, thereby reducing the cost of the community of screening everybody? The second thing is being able to provide greater access to drugs and a system that is more supple, that integrates research into clinical practice.
So more trials.
More trials. A sort of virtuous cycle that needs to be accelerated between discovery and translation into practice and then back into the laboratory to understand where next. There'll always be a where next.
Melissa, what about you? How are you feeling about the future?
Very positive. I think everyone here, like the understanding here and the everyone's working towards a bit like a brighter future, and the cure might not be there, but it will be there one day. Mm. So it's bright for everyone, if not me, but the future is there. And I'm going to have a great time, no matter what that time frame is.
Okay. Erica, what about you? If you have to pay for that Abraxane yourself, what will you do?
Well, yes, I'll probably pay for that myself. But like Melissa, I see that in the broader sphere, the future is bright for cancer research. I don't want anyone to think that I would like people with breast cancer to get less support. Yeah. I would just like the pot to be bigger so that it can include people with pancreatic cancer particularly.
And Navzab, what about you?
Oh, I'm really positive about like cancer research in the future. Like at the moment, I'm on a trial at the moment, it's working wonderfully, and I just hope more people can have access to it because it's doing wonders with me, I guess.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it there. Thank you all very much for joining us tonight. A special thanks to the people who've shared their personal stories with us tonight. I know it's not easy, but greatly appreciated. It was really lovely to have you here, and everyone I'm sure wishes you the very best of luck. That is all we have time for here, but we can keep talking, of course, on Twitter and Facebook. We know cancer affects many, many people, directly and indirectly, so you might want to share your story.
When I saw her, I thought, wow, she's beautiful. It was like a fantasy to me, and I thought I can't ever date white women.
I don't want to be someone's fantasy or fetish. They're dating you solely because you're black.
I'm not selling young Asian woman to a old Caucasian man.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everybody.